Well, g'day, Tubes. How's she going? Pretty good here. Waiting on the garage door guy. He said he was going to call me before he come, but I haven't heard a call yet, so we're still waiting. But anyways, we're gonna work today. Let me open the door here. Oh, come on. I've got one finger. I'm holding my coffee and the camera in the other hand. Come on! Thank you, stupid thing. But anyways, so yeah, we're gonna hit her in here. I'm gonna try my best to nip this stupid tractor starting problem in the butt today, because it's really ticking me off. Honestly, it's really ticking me off. So what we're gonna do is, well, that up there. I'm gonna need some more lights here. I got a little story I was reading to you this. I want to read to you. I was reading this morning on a guy that was having a problem with an outboard engine, and it's sort of the same problem I've been having with this thing. Pardon me. Okay, let's go in and we'll read this little story here. Okay, so this is off a website called boatingmag.com, and this is the guy that was having trouble with his boat engine with cranking and starting. Now, he doesn't go into temperatures and how cold it was or whatever, but pardon me. Anyways, says here, the batteries weren't that old, yet the starter labored with a reluctant before the output would actually eventually kick over. That's what mine's doing. Bench testing the 3-year-old Optima Blue Top Series 27 dual purpose resulted in a clean bill of health. Interesting. On the terminals and lugs, I cleaned the connectors and retightened the nuts, securing the cables to the batteries, battery switch, starter, and engine block, for all for naught. Starting remained anemic at best. Next, he says, I tested the cables for resistance using the ohm function of a multimeter, which I've got here. We're gonna maybe test today. And that's when the first clues emerged. Electrical resistance in the main negative cable connected the engine to the batteries was off the charts. Interesting. Now, I don't know what the charts are supposed to be, but I would presume a brand new nice cable, which I'm going to test, brand new nice cable here, should be pretty much around zero, or maybe a couple of little ohmy things there, you know, but hardly anything. I found the same in the positive cable connecting one of the batteries to the battery switch. So I installed new marine grade thinned copper cables. What a difference. The outboard fired up with a crisp vroom. I also conducted an autopsy of the cables, in which high resistance was high. What I discovered was pure evil. Crumbling wires as brittle as hay and black as coal. Interesting. How had this condition set in? The cables were 7 years old, minor 10, on the tractor. Not ancient, but with 100% saltwater use. Well, I'm not in saltwater, but anyways. Certainly susceptible to corrosion. Salt-laden moisture, perhaps battery acid vapor, had penetrated the insulation, either at lug connection or through a pinhole. Once corrosion has gained a foothold, excess heat wrought by electric resistance had cooked the copper filaments. Bad cables can lead to other problems, including fire. I better switch them. As the alternator tries to move juice through the deteriorating wire, heat can climb to the point of combustion. A bad negative cable can also hamper an alternator's charging capability, which is maybe why it's not charging the battery where it should be, and it's that's another thing that could be going on, right? all from bad cables. Frickin' cables. I never changed them, so I mean, 10 years, that's pretty good. Trying to be able to, and inhibit return to excess voltage to the battery and can result in blown diodes. Could be a diode blown in my alternator too, which I do have a new alternator here, which I was going to change maybe too. Okay, so he gets into, so if battery seems weak, check your cables using 6 proven tips. Danger signs. Listen, weak starting performance is your first clue of something amiss. Don't ignore it. It's funny how it's only when it's cold though, but my machine. Touch, feel the battery cable after a run. If it one feels hot, search for the problem. I've never done that, but who knows. Overheating overheating cables give off an odor. If you whiff something odd, address the issue. I've never smelt anything. Bend, give each cable a gentle bend. If it resists and crackles, you found the problem. Keep an eye on the voltmeter. More than 14.5 volts of an output is a bad sign. Test. Use a multimeter ohm scale to test for resistance. More than an ohm means trouble. Okay, so that's good to know. So, we are going to set up a little test here. I got my Dewey here. I'm going to throw you on a TP here. That's short for tripod. This poor old sap out of the way. I don't know what I'm going to do with him yet. Probably nothing. It's probably just end up in the heap or something. I don't know. But, okay, so let's find our brand new battery cables we got here. And I want to actually do the big one. What did I do with the big one? Over here somewhere. Okay, let me find the big one. And we'll test the ohms on that one just for a starter. Okay, so I've never really tested too much for ohm stuff, so I'm kind of hoping I'm doing this right. Open up this brand new cable here, and I wonder if I had an old crubbly one somewhere. But anyways, this, I presume this should test zero ohms. Okay, so we're gonna spread them out good too. I'll spread it out as best I can anyways. Okay, so now I don't know if I'm gonna be able to get everything in the shot here. It does have a little stand on it. Now, can you guys see that? Let me just see here. Not super great. Okay, there's a bit of shine, but there, that's better. Okay, so I'm just gonna move the cable over here then. So, zero is right there now. Now, technically, I think if you touch these, it does its little read and it comes up to zero because there shouldn't be any resistance between those, right? Okay, so we're gonna put one end on here, there and there, and that's got zero. So that's good. Okay, now I wanna see if I can find something that I know is kinda crubbly. Maybe crack. So this is not really super clean. It should probably come back as pretty crappy here if I put one there. So I guess we're getting almost one ohm. One ohm there, so yeah, that would say if that's not a good test. So let's try this crappy old ball here onto the hitch here, if I can get a connection. Oh man, I'm getting like 30 ohms there. That's not good. Oh, it was this one again. Let's try where we cut. Yeah, so there we're good, because we're on bare metal to bare metal, and it's metal clean all the way through. If we go on this crappy side here, it's not super too bad there, just for different areas. But anyways, so that's that test. That's good to know. Let's just try, actually, let's try my old square here. It's metal. One there, one down there.
Can't really get a good, super good reading off of that, so that's good to know. Anyway, so okay, let's try this guy again. Okay, let's just try something funny here. There to there, of course, zero. There to there, zero. Okay, so that's good to know. Now, what I'm gonna do is actually pull the battery out of the thing right now and bring it in, and up here I've got my tester. We're gonna try the test on the battery right now as it's set in the tractor. Okay, let's go get a battery. Okay, battery is out, freshly out of the tractor. We're gonna test DC volts here. Negative. So I got 12.92. That's not too bad. Yeah. Anyways, this was actually from 2011, this battery, so it might not be a bad idea to really update that. So what we're gonna do here, let's make sure you're in shot. Yeah, okay. For now, save the juice in that. These work on creating a really high draw. There's a heater element in this grilly part here that goes back and forth, and it actually will heat up really hot. Now, it's not on okay. But once I crank this on here, I don't know if you can actually see. I might have to move these a little bit here. Move it right to the top here, maybe. Once we crank this fella up, like this, I think should be up to the okay better, but it's not bad. If it was really bad, it would be down weak or bad. Now, when I pour the juice to this thing here, that I don't think is good. Unless my thing's not working. Oh, there we go. She just had a bad dewy there. Okay. Yeah, okay, now she's cooking. Wasn't quite connected there good, so I don't know, you run this for quite a few seconds here. It's staying in the green here, which is good. And this is, I think it's almost 1,000, not quite 600 and, hang on, oh, she's getting red now. That's probably good, 650 cold crank amps. So that actually performed pretty well there. Oh, sorry, you can't see the dewy here, but you don't want to go much hotter than that, but that's actually performing not too bad there. So I think what I'm going to do is cool that feller down a bit. I think what I'm going to do is keep it going for now. I don't know, it's probably okay. Now I should have been testing as well. Stay. Should have been testing too what the voltage was dropping to there, because it sort of tells you on that thing, but it was holding it around 12, so yeah, we've got 12.50 now, so that's not too bad. I think that battery's okay, actually. Okay, what I'm gonna go do now is pull off the negative wire on the tractor and bring it in, and we'll give that an ohms test. Okay, so there's the negative. Let's give her a shot here. There's somewhere. Oh, interesting. That's showing zero too. Oh, I don't like that. That's not a good thing. Wow, that's disappointing. I kind of thought that one might have been shot, but anyway, so we got positive to pull off here too, and that's the one that's going to be juicing a lot. So let's go grab that one off now. Okay, and there's the positive. Now, if this one's showing 0 ohms, I'm really going to be frazzled here. Better friggin' not. Okay, so come on, baby. Oh my goodness, what the heck? I don't get that. I figured there would have been some resistance there. Oh, maybe there is. Oh, no, it's gone again. Oh, maybe there is. I don't know, it could be just the way you're holding the... I'm on a pretty good spot there, but see, I'm not trying to create a new area. If you dig into it and then dig into here, well, it might show better, but you know, I'm trying just to hold it kind of where stuff was mounted. Yeah, I don't know, maybe it's worth switching them. Probably would make a difference, but because this one, this one's date stamped here, 06/01/2005, so there you go. And it had all this covering stuff on it. I think I might have some more of this stuff to recover, even though I probably could reuse this stuff again. Now, is this a split or has this been... I don't know if I can. This stuff's been kind of mushed on here. It's not really a split. It's a solid loom. I've got some of the split loom, I think, but I don't think I've got any solid stuff. Okay, so I'm not going to put this one back on, like the new one here, because it is a smaller gauge, and I'm going to get the right size gauge. Because these two... doesn't really say what size they are, unless it's in that code. But, yeah, they're both... You know what? Unless the positive has more wrapping on it, I almost say that... Positive is a hair bit bigger, but I don't know what I'm gonna do because they didn't seem to have the bigger gauge I got for the positive in this length. This was a, what the heck was this? 4 gauge. I think the other one I got was, what did I do with the package right here? The other one was a 1 gauge, I think. Yeah, 1 GA, 48 inch. I'll have to see what they have out there. Probably should get the ones from John Deere again, but you know, I kind of wouldn't mind going a little bigger. But yeah, so hopefully that is going to solve a bit of problem. If it doesn't, man, I don't know. I don't know after that. So there's my loom, but it's a split loom stuff. I'll wrap the new positive in that stuff and then have to wrap some tape around it to keep it from maneuvering away from us. Okay, so this stuff's not super awesome to put on. Sometimes it's not bad, but other times it gets kind of like there, bound underneath itself, and you got to wrestle with it a little bit. But sometimes you get a big lucky and the whole bunch goes on, but now it's holding on to this side. There, so you can get her started, right? It works out pretty good usually. Really? Okay, so we got her all wrapped. Maybe should bring her up. We'll just put her like that. I guess that's gonna be in on the battery there anyway. So, okay, so we got her pretty much set there. We're gonna cut. Right about there, should need to wrap the negative, but I remember they had negative cable TSC there when I got these ones, and it was more like a braided cable. I don't know, maybe it'd be better if I got something like that, but... So we're just gonna put a bit of wrap. Maybe so often. Ugh. That's either that or I'm going to have to maybe buy a hunk of welding cable and make my own. I got ends, like I got the battery terminal ends, and then I just have to get like the end that would bolt onto the tractor.
This one's actually a little bit shorter than the stock cable. It's about 4 or 5 inches shorter, so I'm like, ooh. It should get more juice there faster, technically. Anyway. But anyways, okay, so there's that one. We'll go install this one back on the tractor, get ready to hook to the battery. Now, part of the problem could be, too, the connection between the positive here. The positive is kind of crappy looking. It wasn't that long ago I cleaned it, though. And the positive on the battery here is kind of sort of not super nice either, right? So, now maybe I'll get a new battery for it, too, and even though this one seemed to test out all right, probably could clean it up, use her, keep using her, but 2011, that's not too bad. It's had a pretty good run, I would say, but I don't know, maybe it's due. Okay, so I just talked to the John Deere guy, and he's like, 2011, yeah, it's had a warranty. I'd probably put a new one in. Of course he would, because he's selling you a battery, right? But yeah, I kind of sort of agree with that, you know, like, really with the diesel stuff, it's not really getting much use other than the starting or running your lights kind of thing, running the pumps, you know, stuff like that, little things. But yeah, I mean, other than that, she's been pretty good. It's had a pretty good life, I would think, and even though it's still testing decent enough, but that's the thing with what I got to do here is I got to have everything, like, really good, serviced up, ready to go. I can't be having really crap like this happening, right? So, you know, if I get a call today for, oh, I got a funeral for you tomorrow, it's like, well, sorry, bud, I got no battery in my tractor, can't freaking do it. So, that's the downfall. That is the downfall. Now, I'd like to also look in this battery and see what the levels are like. If I can get these caps off, I should have a pair of glasses on. He was going to call me back. He didn't have a battery in stock at the normal guys I go to, but down actually south of here, they've got one in stock, so I might run down to there and get it. He's just going to give them a call and make sure they got it in stock. Okay, so let's have a look inside the battery here and see. It doesn't look too bad in there. I don't have a battery tester, like... Oh, there he is. Okay, hang on. Okay, yep, they got one at the other place, so I'll have to run down there. I kind of hope my garage door guy will be here soon, so I can go down and get that. Still got the glasses on. So, another thing I've noticed with batteries, too, and I've done a video on this before. I think I've cleaned this one before. Is... Normally you would check a battery at the terminals, right? Now, see if that's, yeah, it's not too bad. So, normally, okay, now that's negative there, positive there, we're pulling 12.77. Okay, I'm gonna leave this on the negative. Now, if you don't keep the top of your battery clean, like this one's kinda done a little grimy, if you actually touch like here, it'll show a little bit of voltage. So now if this has got what we'll call a bridge of kind of slimy crappy stuff going all the way over to the positive, see right there, I'm not even on the terminals, I'm on the plastic, and it's showing 5.7 volts. So let's go from this edge to this edge to this edge here. I mean, that's showing almost 5 volts right there, so that could be your parasitic draw right there, even, right? If you don't keep that top of your battery good and clean. Which, now if you give me a few minutes here, I'm going to clean all this off really good. Try not to get crap in the battery. I'm going to clean her off really, really good here. Like, really good. I'm going to get the brake cleaner out and everything, and clean her up real nice, and then we'll do some testing and see if there's any more of that
parasitic draw. That's not good. Parts of the label. I don't think anything else fell in there. Okay. Parts of the stupid label. Now. Okay, so we're just gonna clean this up really good here. I'm still getting junk off. Clean this up really good, even down the sides, anywhere that you think might transfer, you know, electrons and stuff. Even I've seen it even go into the labels. Now he said, oh, if you bring it back, we'll give you a $15 core on it. I'm like, I might as well just keep it. Okay. So now, the video has not been stopped or altered or anything here. So we're going to go back to DC voltage here. This stupid meter's always red weird. Okay, so negative there. We'll do a negative to the positive. Make sure we still got our 0.77. Okay, that's good. We'll leave this one on the negative and we'll go over here. Oh, I'm still getting a little bit. 2 volts. And I'm on the plastic here, so not quite half a volt. Oh, 3 volts there. Holy cow, so it's still got some grime on there. Now, brake cleaner probably isn't the best stuff for cleaning the battery with, but geez, it shouldn't get any cleaner than that, you wouldn't think. Okay, that's about the best I can do, I think, other than pressure washing it. So, negative here. Oh, that might be my garage door guy. Okay, yeah, garage door guy's on his way, so that's good. I can look at my battery and stuff after, too. Okay, so, ooh. So negative here. Positive on the positive terminal. We got 12.77. Okay, let's go. That's a little better. Yeah, that's a little better now. After that second wipe. Should be zero, but there's still 1 point something there, so that's not good. I mean, you can't be swabbing off your batteries all the time, but I'll tell you, it could have been part of the problem too with... Sometimes I've seen it where you can't clean them. Well, that's good there. That's zero. That's zero. That's zero. There was a little bit here though, I think. Yeah. So, now let's even try down on the side here. See, it's getting 2-something volts there, so... Now that doesn't mean that it's going to, now I've cleaned this, it'll probably be alright, but if this was all gooey and stuff, it could travel voltage and ground, you know, and then kill your battery, right? It'll just eventually juice your battery right out, and that at the end of your battery, you wonder why is it dead? Well, there you go. So, battery maintenance is very, very important. So anyways, I won't film the garage door guy, you probably wouldn't like that, so I'll let you know what happens after he's done looking. Okay, garage door guy's done. About 20 minutes maybe. We've got a new seal on the bottom, new seals around the perimeter of the door. We're gonna put her down here now. He changed the type of seal on the bottom here. The other one was like a clip-on thing where this one's like screwed right in. And this stuff you slide in on this track is kind of cool. And that should seal things up a little more better. Is the plan. So let's see now. I should have maybe checked it while it was here, but oh yeah, that's way more better now. Can't see no light. Yeah, that's better. I think that should be good. And he also fixed up there for me too. He threw a couple more of them, what he called tech screws in there. Fastened her down. He's like, yeah, that's funny. This one right, not the very bottom one, but the one that's in the bracket.
bottom one? He says, that's funny, they never put one in there. Yeah, I'm like, there's nothing there. It was nothing drilled, nothing, you know. So we put another one there on the very bottom, one in the middle. I think he replaced one on the top and got that bracket sucked in a little better. So that should be good. I'm a happy camper. And it looks like a better seal all around. I won't know until, you know, it gets warm back here and it melts all this water up here. Hopefully it's a lot better now. I can still see a little gap there, but, you know, it's not going to be bang on perfect. It's not, you know, not technically airtight. There's still going to be some somewhere. But I was also asking him about this door. And I was like, are these rated by an R value? He's like, yeah. I'm like, oh, well, what's this one? He's like, probably about an R2. I'm like, yeah, no doubt. It's freaking cold. He's like, yeah, I think we're installing ones now that are up to an R16. I'm like, oh, wow, that'd be all right. But anyways, yeah. So, but everything else he says looks good. Should be good to go. Anyways, I'm going to measure this cable here and see if I can get one. I'd rather get one that's kind of ready to go, done, but this one was kind of crimped on. Nothing special, so maybe, you know, worst comes to worst, I could get a roll of welding wire. Where did my welder go? It's back here. Like, I don't know what gauge it is, but it's pretty wicked thick stuff. That's probably at least a 1 gauge or something. Maybe get a roll of that, and I can make my own negative, because I've got cable ends. They're not super great ones though. Maybe I'll see what I can find that's pre-made, but these ones are kind of chintzy, where you clamp them down and, you know, away you go, but where that is kind of like a molded around the cable kind of thing. I don't know how they do that. If they have like a mold of this guy and they just kind of lay the cable in and then just the lead in there and then it solidifies around it, and away you go. They might have to drill the holes out and stuff, you know, to make her good, but I don't know how those work. So we're going to do some running around. We'll run and grab a cable, see what I can get at TSC, and then I'm going to run over and grab that battery from a place called Ospringe. Turn all these things off here. Up. Oh, it's not working. Tricked you. It's working. So we'll show you the seals on the outside here too. He didn't put a whole pile of screws in, which I would have liked a few more put in it, you know, but because sometimes these will kind of buckle up a little bit and then you'll get right through, right? Oh man, still coughing. Really what they should have probably done is run a bead of silicone on the backside of this and then screw it on, but anyways. So yeah, that's sealing lots nicer in there now. Look at that. Just like silicone. So, and that's got a double thing where he says, oh yeah, your ones were just like the single crappy ones. So, that's good there. I'll hit there. Oh, I can't get in. Just leave. So, leave. But it looks nice now. The door is all grimy. Holy cow, I need to wash my door. But, got no water on this time of year, so. Ew, it's pretty dirty. Ugh, yeah, it needs cleaned. But anyways, let's go fire up the old EcoBoost, and we'll head her out to TSC maybe first, see what we can find for cable-wise. I'd really like to get one. Oh, crap, I didn't measure that cable. Hang on, I gotta go measure the cable. And then we'll hit her out. So tell me something. How come I was able to start my truck from down at my garage, okay? That's a fair distance down there. It's about 300 feet, 400 feet away maybe. I was able to start it from down there. And sometimes I'm walking across a parking lot from here to say my pole away and it won't even lock the doors. Any idea on why it's doing that? Now I know the little receiver dewey, I think it's that little black knob on the top there, but it was actually away from me and I stand, you know, 30 feet from it and it won't even open the doors. Or start or nothing. So if anybody's got any ideas what's going on there, and yes, I have changed the batteries in both my keys. It was doing it before I changed the batteries and then it's doing it sort of now too. But today, I thought, oh, let's try her from down, way down there. Ow. Sure enough, she started from way down the garage, which is like 350 odd feet away-ish. So I don't know what's going on there, if, you know, there's something weird with air currents and it won't start. Well, that was crunchy. It won't start because of weird air currents and it's moving my signal away from my truck. I don't know. It's weird. Why would it do that? If you know, let me know. And both keys will do the exact same thing. If it is working, it's working. If it's not working, it's not working. Both of them are exactly the same. It's not like one's working and one's not working and vice versa and whatever. But I don't know. Maybe it depends where you are, if there's more interference with other things or something. I don't know. But we're going to head to TSC first. See what we can find for cabley wise. I might have to make one. I don't know. I don't want to have to, but if I do, I do, I guess. We'll see what we can get, though. All right, they had a 1-gauge wire, but only 15 inches. Or this one, which is a 1-gauge wire that is 48 inches. So I got another one of these, just like the positive one. And I don't know if I'm going to chop it or what. And put ends on. I did get ends. That's the funny thing here. These are ends for a welding cable, okay? They should fit all right. And then, you know, bare the wire and then smush this down into the wire. That should work fine for the negative. But the funny thing is, in the battery section, the cables and all that stuff, they have these. It's not Hobart. It's like whatever this quick is. Quick whatever, you know. And they had a pack of two of them for $14.99. I'm like, really? I went down the welding section and got two of these for like $4.99. I'm like, holy friggin' crap. You know, these are meant for a welder, which is like, you know, huge amount of power coming back. So I'm pretty sure these should work fine, but holy frig. And they looked exactly the same, identical. I'm like, wow. You know, maybe it's a different metal or something, but I'm pretty sure these should work fine. But worst comes to worst, if I don't like it, I might just, you know, put this feller on and then just, you know, I could maybe even find another spot to ground it out to the frame of the tractor somewhere. I mean, it doesn't have to go to the exact same spot it was at. I could always stretch her out, you know, and find somewhere else different maybe, but I don't know. We'll try her out. But that's funny because I did find on this old cable, I did see it somewhere up here, I think it was. Yeah, it's a 4-gauge. 4-gauge. 4AWG. Now that's pretty much all they sell in there is the 4-gauge stuff. They have very little of anything any bigger or smaller number. So I ended up getting the big fella here. That's about all I could get. They had another 1-gauge, but it was only 12 inch. I'm like, oh, it's way too short. I'd have to like drill to something somewhere and then attach her that weight onto the tractor. I'm like, oh, I'm sure I can find another bolt somewhere I can ground that to, you know. And bolt that the original cable was grounded to come out, and it looked clean, fresh, brand new, not rusted or nothing. So that looks like it was sealed in there pretty good. Where it was a great big huge long screw too, holding her in. I guess it goes through the frame and then into the hole or something. But the bolt come out, it was nice and clean. So that made me feel pretty good that it was getting a good ground there. So that seemed all right. But we're gonna head her, I guess, to the John Deere guys now. It's a little bit of a drive. It's about the same actually. I don't know what's with Orangeville. It's in the middle of everything. I don't have a John Deere dealer close here. I don't have a Princess Auto close here. You know, all the good stores I like to shop at are 45 minute drive, if not further away. It's like, really? We're in the middle of freaking nowhere here. What the heck? You know, like, this is a town of like probably almost 70,000 people, if not maybe a few more here and there. And we don't even have a freaking Princess Auto near us, or a John Deere dealer that's really close to us. You know, it's like, what the heck? Kind of ticks you off, you know. You're kind of like, I'm dying to get a Princess Auto around here. So even out in the country out here somewhere would be perfect. There's, you know, there's a land right here they could, that's just come up for sale. This building and stuff used to be a wood skid pallet crate place. Crates Unlimited it was called, and it's for sale now. So I mean, they could buy that and throw a Princess Auto in there. Like, what the heck? I got everything around me, but not near me, which really sucks. So that's why I got to put all these miles on just to go get a freaking battery, you know? Like, I could have got a battery, you know, a TSC there, but something like that, I'd rather get genuine, you know, from the dealer kind of guy thing. Whatever. So anyways, I asked my wife if she wanted to go. She hasn't responded back yet, so I don't know. I'll go and wait a few minutes, see if she wants to go or not with us, and if not, then we'll head her over. Alrighty, so way off in the distance on the left, not quite to the top of that hill, way, way up there is where we are going. I can just barely see their big sign from here, so as we get closer, it should hopefully get larger, the sign, and we'll be able to see that it says John Deere Premier Equipment, and a picture of a big yellow deer on a green backing kind of thing, right? Hopefully. I'm pretty sure this is the one. Yeah, I think so. We needed to go to a little town called Osbridge, and it's pretty much this little, it's got its own traffic light, but if you blink a couple of times, you'll definitely miss it. So, the John Deere sign is getting bigger and the driveway is getting closer. And that is super awesome. They even advertise their premier rentals out here, as in renting machines, but the guy I talked to says, no, I got all mine out in snow contracts. I'm like, oh, great, that helps. You know, so if a guy like me breaks down, needs to dig a big hole, I can't. But, anyways, he's, I don't know what he said, the 35 was the equivalent roughly to the 110, which is that little Mini X there. That looks pretty darn close. It looks like my 24-inch bucket on there. Looks a little smallish though, but 35G, and then there's a 35D over here. But I don't really by chance want to get into doing Mini X stuff. But anyways, we're here. I won't film in here, of course, and man, if you want to buy a lawn tractor this time of year, too freaking bad. I guess they'd have to dig one out for you. But anyways, we'll go ahead and grab battery, and hopefully good to go. Okay, we got a battery. Very good to go. We're just going to have a little looky around here. I don't even think these guys sell construction, like big construction equipment-y stuff. Because you think they might have would have had something sitting here. They got all, like, you know, smallery kind of stuff and like the big farm ag stuff, but not the big stuff. John Deere's really weird with that, you know? Like, there's one guy in this district that's allowed to sell construction stuff, and they're down in Mississauga for like this whole area. It's really weird. I don't know. I thought for sure that the guy that I normally deal with said, well, we could maybe get one bought through Osbridge and do it that way. I'm like, okay. But then he says no. So, I don't know, it's really, really weird. They're more into the agricultural-y stuff up here, but construction stuff, you have to get it from the city, but, oh, it looks like this header here's been experienced with corn. A little bit corn dangling off her. But anyways, this one's had a bit of use too. Wow, we burnt right out, maybe. But anyways, they got another driveway here. I'm gonna use her, and we're gonna head her home. We'll check out the new battery and figure out what we're going to do for cable-y wise here, and go from there. Okay, there is our new battery, still in the box even. It gets much newer than that. Now, Buddy scratched out February 4, 5 for 15. So there we go. So we're going to yank it out of the box here. Ugh. I'm sure not making them any lighter. So that's all good. What I'm going to do is, he juiced her there, but you know, batteries actually start to get power as soon as you pour the acid into them. So what I'm going to do though is, they put them on the charger there, but he says, oh, it's only on for an hour. So I think what I'm going to do is juice her overnight, or for a good part of the afternoon. So I know that she's right up full. Let's grab our meter again here just to make sure. Okay. So we're showing the same voltage as this battery, so I think this battery was probably still good, but I mean, it's a good thing to keep batteries, you know, 4 years, that's pretty freaking good, and it's still in that decent of shape. Let's just quickly, I got my lunch here, pizza, yummy, starving. Let's just quickly do another test on this guy. So 12.71. Oh, hiya. Ooh, huh. She's a little more juiced than the old one. But anyways, we're going to... Okay, so she's 12.71. Turn it to 12 volt. And then now we're getting 13.50. She's jumping up pretty good there now. That'll juice her up real good, and tells you on here how many amps you're putting into it, and it's less than 1 amp she's drawing, so it's probably almost full. But I'll let her sit there for the afternoon maybe and continue to juice, and I'll put her in maybe tomorrow. So we'll leave that off for now. I'm going to have my lunch. There's our new cable. We're going to run that to the negative. It's probably way too long. But like I say, I can probably find another spot. As long as it's somewhere fairly beefy, decent on the tractor, I can run that to there. So, that one's garbage. Gotta have my garbage. There's another old cable I found. I don't know what they were from. Probably the old Ford tractor, but they're pretty much junk. So, anyways, we'll let this juice. I'll eat lunch, and then we'll route this negative. And I think I might even look into, where's my light? Am I, let's left my light out here. I think I'm gonna even maybe, if I can get in here, where the frick is it? I probably wouldn't be able to do it until I get the loader up out of the way. I wanna switch that alternator in there maybe too. Check that wire for maybe some resistance. There's a wire, the charger here, right? Could be some resistance there. There's diodes and stuff in here that might be fried. It's letting the power kinda come back through. Grounds out back to the tractor, right? So we'll check her out and see. Okay, well, we're just about ready to pull this alternator out of here. I got everything unhooked. It's not super fun getting in here with these side plates on. I probably could have busted them off, but loose too. Wow. But anyways, I didn't. I'm just kind of working around it here. But yeah, she's a little tight. Mostly because of this clamp here that's digging into my freaking hand. Okay. Out she comes. There she be. Okay, that wasn't too bad. Bit of dirt in there. But yeah, I don't have a tester for these guys. I'd have to take it somewhere to get her tested. But regulator built in. That's good. And the numbers... 2951 on that even, really? Oh, okay, so let's go get the new one. Okay, so there's the new one. Sorry, I can't get you in a really good spot here. No different number. Doesn't tell you what amperage or anything, but these are supposed to be, I think, around a 55 maybe. Even comes with a pulley. I've had alternators before. You had to take the old pulley off and use your old pulley, so she's good and complete. That's good. Now this part I'm really not looking forward to. Come on, light, work with me. What the frig? Stupid light. Okay, you can just maybe hang there. So, it's nice of them to give you a little stud to hang it off first here. And then get the nut started again. It was a 15 mil nut up here and a 13 on the top. Okay, so I won't crank that right tight yet. We gotta get this guy started too so we can tighten the belt on her. Now, from what I remember, taking her apart, I got to get the belt on the alternator here first.
hopefully everything is still aligned down below and she doesn't have any problems. It looks good there and there and there. So this is a little spacer, and then the bolt goes through. Get started in here. It's a horrible view, I know, for you guys, but with the arm down here, it's probably about the best I can get you. Now I need a 13. That's a 12 sided. I don't really want to use 12, but now this doesn't have like the adjuster nut thingy, so you've got to kind of just reef down on her and tighten her, I guess. And that tightens your belt. I almost need to get maybe something in behind there, something small. Even one of these guys might work. Let's make sure I got my ratchet in tighten mode. I mean, that's not gonna work. Now I gotta get in here and try to crank this feller down. Fan blade in the way. Should have a wrench in there, but that's probably gonna hold her now. Now I can get in there and crank her down. Should do her. Now the bottom one, put this guy back. That was a 13. All the chrome's coming off that guy. I must use it a lot. And this one wasn't a whole lot of fun to get into either here. Gotta get in and around the belt between the all the shroud and the I think that should do. Okay, so let's just check and make sure we're tight. Beautiful. No slippage there. That guy back. Whoa. Okay, that's not where that one goes. I guess that one goes there. And now we've got to hook up the wires. And I was going to... oh crap, I need that other nut. I was going to check the wire in here, but it's like all goes all into one huge harness, and really I'm not too sure where it goes after that. So I'm gonna hopefully assume that everything's okay here. And that one pretty clean, so I think we'll drive on, but now I gotta get the little nut off the other guy. All right, I think that should do her. Just can't get in here. Good. I just use my little guy here for cranking this down. I don't think these are the right size. No. Really have a nice metric set here. I do, but let's use my little guy here. Okay, re-alternator. Now there is pretty much absolutely nothing else that I can replace on this for this stuff. So I mean, if there's still something wrong with the starting, I don't know. I'm friggin' lost. Probably something really stupid, but we might have fixed her with that alternator too because of that diode problem. If it had a problem, if the diode was right out of it. Now what a diode is, it only lets the electricity go one way, so instead of when the tractor's shut off, the battery's feeding back through here,
into that alternator, through the alternator, and then ground it back out to the frame and then back to the battery. That would kill your battery, you know, fairly quick. But that's it. All right, so we're juicing here almost at 15 volts. I don't really know how many amps, but it's maybe pulling like a, hardly any. So I'd say she's pretty much topped right up. Ooh, all of a sudden she jumped 15.2. Ooh, well, I gotta go do a little more running around. And maybe we'll come back, we'll see what she's sitting at, and then we'll give her a shot. See how she goes. Better friggin' go. And I'm gonna need to use it on Saturday. I'm just looking at my weather dewey here. Sunday was supposed to be really cold. Let's crank her up here. Really gotta go pee. I know you didn't need to know that, but oh, that's why I'm jumping. Anyways, yeah, Sunday right now is saying minus 20. Saturday minus 11. So what I'm gonna do is do my funeral stuff on Saturday here. Leave her out overnight, and I don't know. We'll leave her a little longer, maybe till 9 o'clock on Sunday, and I'll come down. We'll give her a cold start. See if we've solved everything here. If not, then I don't know. I don't know what the next deal would be, except, you know, throw it over the cliff. But anyways, yeah, I gotta go do. Oh no, she's dropped a bit again. Isn't that funny? All of a sudden, whoop, and then. Oh, 15, 40, 99. Weird. But anyways, yeah, we'll leave this sitting, and then we'll come back and then see what she's doing. Okay, we're back. Oh, good thing this has got an auto-off, because she auto-offed on me. I'm going to double-check this. We're at 15 still. That's good. Now, if we take, turn this off here, she should drop rapidly to about 12, almost 13 maybe. So we'll let that, well, I can't take those off now yet. Anyways, we'll let that sort of drop a bit there because it's not juicing it now, right? It's just kind of going to level off at like 12, should be 12, well, almost 13-ish maybe. So we got everything good here. I just got to double make sure that I got everything's marked negative. And I did actually run this across and then bolt it onto another great big bolt across there instead of chopping the wire. I just really didn't want to chop the wire, so... those, I don't know where those are going to go while I'm trying to get this in here, but, it'll stay there maybe. Okay. Well, we're going to do a bit of testing here too. On the alternator when it's running and not running, see what the voltage is sitting at, make sure it's charging to like 15-ish, around there it should be. And then check the battery and make sure, yeah, it's still dropping a bit, 1280, it's leveling off a bit now. Check the battery to make sure it's close enough. Make sure it's getting a charge as well. Otherwise there could be something wrong with the wiring, but I think it's okay. I hope it's okay. So that's kind of got casted a little weird, but I think it should be all right. And I don't know, this one I put goo on it when I did it, but maybe I will with this one too. It kind of helps keep them from corroding and making more of a mess there, right? Although I don't know why, because I guess there's because there's the electricity's jumping from one to the other, you know, and then it's creating something there, like, I don't know exactly, but it makes it go corrody and stuff. So put the goo on it, seems to help. Okay, new battery is going in. Oh man, they don't make them too light, let me tell you. Okay, so, positive. I'm positive, this is the positive. Of course, it's twisted weird. There, it's kind of strange. Ah.
Oh, those are, that's a tight fit. That one's not. That's weird. Well, what am I going to do with that? I'm going to have to try to spread that guy open a little bit. Okay, I thought that was a little weird shape on the terminal on this battery. Hopefully it's okay. I'm pretty sure it will be. I'll crank them down good. Super awesome, good connection there. Definitely tight. This one slipped right on, so I guess it was all right. Should do, good and tight. Now, I'm not gonna be able to show you probably the meter here, but I will relay the numbers I find. That we're gonna put right to the battery. And this one I'm gonna touch here. So we've got 1272 at the alternator. And for cornflakes, I put the cover back on here. Hang on, I'll pull the cover off here again. It's not fun to put this cover on when you got the loader arm down. It sucks. Of course, it comes off fine, but trying to get it lined up in there again is not fun. Okay, so now at the starter, 12.72, so that's good. That's good, I like that. And we can probably fire it up here now. Okay, I'm gonna have to get this cover right out of here. Oh man, stupid thing. Okay, so let's just recap. We got a 12.72 at the alternator here. Okay, I think we're good to just give it a little fire up here and make sure everything's charging too. Open the door. Okay, so here's our first contact, new battery and cables. Now I might have to rev up a bit, show a charge here, but we'll see what it says. Probably leave this outside overnight. It's supposed to be like minus 12 by tomorrow morning, which is the same temp that we've been trying to start this at, where it's been sort of failing and being really crappy and stuff. I think I'm gonna leave her out overnight and we'll try her in the morning. I don't want to get her out here too warmed up, so we'll just take her out and shut her off again. Shut her down. Shut her down. Get her right out here in a nice cold. Shut her down. So, presuming everything's... Oh, that's loose. That's not good.
Pretty sure everything's shut off here now. Now I'm not going to unhook the negative or nothing. I'm just going to leave her as if she was, you know, parked here all night. Seems like it's cranking better there, but I don't know. We won't know till morning. One more. Sealed. Nice. That looks really good. So, that is that, I guess. He did a really good job at that. And new Dewey on the bottom too, which was super awesome and should be good. Okay, all you computer guys, got a question for you. Some reason my Bluetooth thing, when I hooked to my phone thingy, in this screen here, if you press down here, it was entertainment. It used to bring up what song was playing, the rewind, pause, fast forward, whatever, on the screen. Now, for some reason, it's just brought up that. And I don't know why. I don't know how to, what happened, if I accidentally changed something or whatever. I don't know. I can't seem to get it to go back. It always seems to default to that. And it's really annoying because you can't really sort of tell, unless you're listening, what song's coming up. It's nice to glance down and see. Now, there's other ways you can look to see. If you just go to the main home screen, it'll actually show you down in here. Down in here, what song's playing. But it's really annoying because I really like to have that screen up. And I've repaired my phone to the truck here, nothing. Disconnected my my Bluetooth, reconnected, nothing. Goes back to that default screeny thing. So I don't know what to do to fix that. So if anybody knows, let me know. But anyways, we're going to leave the old girl sitting out overnight. It's only -4 now. Let's double C check the temperature. Load up. So, it's actually going to get colder tomorrow. So, we're at -5. Focus. Actually, hang on. There. That's why it wouldn't focus. We're at -5 right now. Tonight, it's supposed to go down to -12. 13 in the morning. And afternoon, -17. Now, I don't want to really leave that out if it's going to be sunny, because it says partially sunny but really cold. But I wouldn't mind leaving it out somewhat tomorrow, maybe a bit. But I think I'm going to come down and around, try it at around 9 o'clock or something, where it's going to be more like a -12 or 13-ish. And try starting her then and see how it sounds when it cranks. If it cranks like it did when it's inside nice and warm, I think we fixed it. If it's still slow, then I don't know. And then Saturday I'm going to need to use it for digging. -11, and then I was going to drop down to like -20 that night on Sunday, and 24. That's really going to give her a good test. Holy frick. But anyways, and then after that, it's like summertime, so I guess we'll just leave her outside tonight. We'll try her tomorrow, see how she's looking. I wouldn't mind maybe getting a meter on it to see what it's reading when we're cranking it. It's kind of hard because the battery's on the far side. I gotta sort of be over here and cranking it on this side, so yeah. But that's what we're gonna try. We're gonna try that tomorrow. So, but anyways, that's probably it for today. After this, I really don't know. It seemed to be charging good there on all the ends and stuff. Battery was the same, the alternator was the same, so that means, that's telling me that line is good, the charging line. So I don't know. I'm wondering if maybe a diode was screwed. Probably from some guy welding on the tractor without unhooking the battery and stuff. That'll fry it. But that's all we can do. But anyways, hopefully that has cured it, because there's nothing else on this thing that I can change. Alternator, 2 battery cables, battery, starter. I mean, that's it. As far as I know, there's nothing else. You know, but maybe there's a couple of fuses there or something too, but they're probably those, it's not likely a fuse, it's those, what do they call them? Those big blocks that slam into the thingy dewey. That's likely what is. It would have to be really heavy for that. So for that kind of draw, you know, that kind of amperage would have to be really heavy resetting dewey or whatever you call it. So yeah, but I guess that's it for today. We'll try her out first thing in the morning. Fingers are crossed again. Look, we got turkeys moving into my front yard. What a bunch of freaking turkeys. Holy cow, usually they're coming back this time of day. They're sort of heading. Whoa, buddy! Easy! Don't let her throw ya! That was funny as hell, that was. Holy crap! Poor guy ran out of legs. Oh man, that was funny. I haven't laughed like that for a long time. Oh dear. Anyways, let's get serious here. Let's go park and then we'll open up a kinder maybe today because I think I got enough time. It's only 20 after 3. The kitties will be home soon. All right, let's see if we can do it. Oh, nice. Into the spot. Anyways, let's go open a kinder. Okay, so I had to get a new mouse the other day, and that's what I got. Logitech, sort of kind of a really good one. I guess it's got a rechargeable battery in it, so you plug it into the USB dewey for, you know, 6 years, and then it charges. But so far, I'm not super crazy on it, but maybe it'll grow on me in a bit. I don't know. I'm not used to, like, the fancy grippy ones, right? So, whoa, that one just blew out of the gate. Hey, this looks kind of cool. It looks like a moose or some kind of aminal. Oh, there's a aminals. Oh, I like the one I got too. I think that's the one. I think we got this this feller here. Whoa, sorry. The polar bear would be kind of cool too, though. Okay, yeah, this is a whatever that guy is. So, first of all, they say to start with the head of him, put on his dewies. That's a good rack there. That guy there, but I think we better put the other side of him on first. That guy there. That guy there. Geez, I never got wildlife before in a kinder. That's kind of cool. It's like an elk or some guy. Huh. Nothing like Canadian elk, eh? So yeah, there's quite a few. There's like a wolf, seal, an otter, a fox, a bear, a penguin, a walrus. Quite a few guys you can collect. That's kind of cool. But anyways, that's it for today. We'll catch you tomorrow and try our cold start again and see if we're any better or worse or whatever. But anyways, have a good night. Thanks for watching.